I don't know if I told the story of Charlie here 2 years ago, but if you haven't heard it, you ought to hear it. There must be one person here that needs to hear it. The story of Charlie sort of puts shoes on this whole thing. What does it mean to put on the robe that has not one thread of human devising? Charlie was a student in my class at Pacific Union College. And I didn't like him. The class was arranged with students on this side, students on that side, an aisle down the center, and a row across the back against the wall. And Charlie sat in that middle chair at the end of the aisle and stared at me every day. Just stared at me. And he made me nervous. And I decided that he didn't like me. And then he probably got in my class by mistake. And he ruined my class period. And I would dread going to class because of Charlie. I finally found myself teaching the kids on this side for a while. Then I'd go over the top of Charlie and teach them over here for a while. Then I'd go underneath Charlie and come back over here. I didn't want to see him. Then one day, while we were talking about some of these things, Charlie came down after class. He said, "Teach, could I talk to you?" Okay, so we went to my office and I said, "What do you need?" He said, "I don't understand. I don't understand this business of righteousness by faith." And I thought to myself, if you would stop staring at me and listen, maybe you would. But I didn't say it. So I said, "Well, Charlie, tell me a little bit about yourself, where you come from." And a most amazing story unfolded. Charlie had been sitting in prison for murder in the San Francisco Bay Area just a few months before. He knew nothing of God or faith. His mother came to see him one day. She was dying of cancer. She tried to talk to him through the bars, but she couldn't get it out. All she could do was cry. He said goodbye, and his mother left. That's the last time he saw her alive. He went back to his cell, and he cried for 3 days. At the end of 3 days, he looked up toward heaven. He said, "God, if there's a God up there, I could sure use you." Well, to his surprise, his case came to court. They did not have sufficient evidence, and the case was dismissed. And Charlie walked down the street a free man. His girlfriend, with whom he had been living for 3 years, didn't realize this. He went to the place where they had lived, found her in the living room having a Bible study with a Seventh-day Adventist Bible instructor. She was delighted to see him. She said, "Come in and share in the Bible study." "Oh, no," he said. He went into the back room till they were finished. Then he came out and tried to talk with her about continuing where they had left off. And she wasn't interested anymore. She said, "I will find a place for you to live. And will you please come to the studies?" So she did, and he did. He came to the studies. And little by little, he began to get something in his mind about Jesus and the gospel. Some public meetings came to the Bay Area, and they persuaded Charlie to go. So he went to the meetings. And when the meetings were finished, he accepted Christ the best he knew how, and they baptized him. But he still had four problems. He was still smoking. He was still drinking. He was still cussing, and he was still on drugs. And they baptized him. Too soon? Somewhere along the line, Charlie had gotten the idea that Adventists didn't go for these four things. So he began trying hard to do something about them. He began working on the first one. Then he'd go to work on the second. By the time he got to number three, number one was back in again. And he worked in futile effort trying to get over his problems until one night he gave up. When we submit ourselves to Christ. He looked up toward heaven again and he said, God, if anything gets done about these problems, you'll have to do it, and you'll have to do it all. By this time, I was sitting on the edge of my seat. I said, what happened? He said, God did it all. What do you mean? He took away my desire for all of them. But he said, I don't understand about righteousness by faith. And I wanted to laugh. I said, Charlie, righteousness by faith is an experience, not just a theory. And it sounds to me like the Lord has led you there. Would you tell the class tomorrow about this? Oh, I don't know. You think I should? I said, yes. Well, if you think I should, I will. I did, and he did. And the next day in class, when he told his experience, I was impressed because he talked more about Jesus than he did about Charlie. But the thing that bothered me, and I never told him, when he told me about how God did it all, I was angry. I had been working on my sins for years. And here God comes along and gives it to Charlie. That's not fair. Well, I've heard some people say, well, that's true. There are some people that are so weak that God has to do it all. But those of us who have some strength, we have to do our part. No. God doesn't play favorites. He treats everybody the same. And I had to face the cruel fact that I do not get the gift that God has to offer until I get to the same place that Charlie was. To the end of my own resources. And when I get there, I get the same gift because the robe is free. The robe is just as free as the invitation. Real victory is getting the victory over trying to get the victory. Some of us try so hard to go to sleep at night that we wake ourselves up. And some of us spend so much time fighting the devil, become more like him. And our only hope is to look away from ourselves to Jesus. And everybody, when Jesus comes, is going to have understood that. And the ones who are at the marriage supper of the King's Son and have the robe on will have understood that. And those who don't have the robe on will also have understood it. That's why they will be speechless. Are you thankful for not only the invitation, but the robe provided? When we get the invitation, we have to RSVP. We're all familiar with that. And this is the way it might go. Two choices. We RSVP with a note like this: to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, I have received your invitation to be present at the marriage of your son. I pray thee, have me excused. Or, to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, I have just received your urgent invitation to be present at the marriage of your son. By your grace, I'll be there. And P.S., thank you for the beautiful robe. Dear Father in heaven, we're thankful that in the time of the judgment, we can have good news like this. Please lead us to what it means to submit, to come to the end of our own ropes and receive all of your gifts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distress, He kindly will help me. He ever loves and cares for His own. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, Jesus can help me, Jesus alone. I must tell Jesus.